So as I said, entries R is the number of subsets of size R from a set of n elements. And we have this formula that entries R is n factorial divided by R factorial multiplied with n minus R factorial. So we use it below and we see that 4 choose 2 is 4 factorial divided by 2 factorial multiplied with 2 factorial, which is equal with 6. So there are 6 subsets of size 2 that you can choose out of a set of 4 elements. Similarly, 8 choose 5 is 8 factorial divided by 5 factorial multiplied with 8 minus 5 factorial, which you can see above that 5 factorial can be actually simplified. And then 6 is actually the same with the product of 3 and 2. Therefore, the only two terms that remain in the numerator are 8 and 7. So 8 multiplied with 7 is 56. So you can choose 5 distinct sets. You can choose 56 distinct sets of size 5 out of an original set of 8 elements. Now, what would be the number of sets that you can choose of size n out of a set of n plus 1 elements? And actually, if you use the formula, you will see that it will be n plus 1 factorial divided by n factorial multiplied with n plus 1 minus n factorial. But n plus 1 minus n is basically 1. 1 factorial is 1. So this will be n plus 1 factorial divided by n factorial. But n plus 1 factorial can be written using the recursive formula into n plus 1 multiplied with n factorial. N factorial in the numerator is eliminated because it's divided by n factorial in the denominator. And now we are getting n plus 1. So basically, we are told that if we want to select sets of size n out of a set of size n plus 1, the number of distinct such subsets of size n is n plus 1, which is logically correct, because how do you select subsets of size n out of a set of n plus 1 elements? You eliminate an element, and you can eliminate each element once. So if you eliminate the first element, you get a set of n elements that follow it. If you eliminate the second element, then you get a set of the elements that are the first element and the elements after the element that you eliminated, and so on for all the elements of the set. So you basically get n plus 1 sets for of size n out of a set of n plus 1 elements. And you can use it now. So for instance, how many subsets of size 4 you can extract from a set of 5 elements? Immediately you can see that is 5. Basically, you can eliminate the first set, and then you get the first element, and then you get the set of the next 4 elements. You can eliminate the second element, and then you get basically the set of 4 elements, that is the first element and the next last 3 elements, and so on. And similarly, 10 choose 9 will be equal with 10. 100 choose 99 will be equal with 100, and so on. Next is mathematical induction. So the principle of mathematical induction is a valid logical argument that allows you to prove a property for all the integers n, starting with a base case. So let's start with defining p of n as a property that is defined for all integers n, and let a be a fixed integer, like for instance a equal 1 or a equal 0. Suppose that the following two statements are true. P of a is true, and for all integers k greater than equal with a, if p of k is true, then p of k plus 1 is true. Then the statement for all integers n greater than a, greater than equal with a, p of n is true, is true. That is, we just defined a logical argument that says that if P of A is true, and for all k greater than or equal with A, P of K implies P of K plus 1, therefore, P of N is true for all N greater than or equal with A. So we basically, from the fact that the first element is true and the implication must be true, which says that if the first element is true, the following element is also true. But now if the following element is true, then the next element is also true, and so on. This propagates to infinity for all integers, indices from A to infinity. Okay? Any questions? So it seems there are no questions. Let's return back to the lecture. So this method, the method of proof using mathematical induction, applies to statements of this form. We want to prove that for all integers n greater than or equal with a, some property p of n is true. And of course, this is an infinite number of such elements. So we want to find a method of proof that applies for all indices greater than A, which is an infinite set. The first step, also called the base step, says try to show that P of A is true. So for the first element, the property is true. The next step, called the inductive step, tells us show that for all integers k greater than or equal with a, if p of k is true, then p of k plus 1 is also true. This is a method of direct proof. So what you are going to do is to choose an arbitrary k, arbitrary chosen, such that you assume p of k to be true, and from that infer that p of k plus 1 must also be true. Now, the first part of this implication is called the inductive hypothesis. So you suppose that P of K is true, where K is any particular but arbitrary chosen integer for K greater than or equal with A. Then you show that P of K plus 1 must also be true based on the fact that P of K was true. Let's actually see a couple of examples, and then you will get the feeling of how to prove such mathematical inductions. We'll start with an example from the real world, which basically says that for all integers n greater than or equal with 8, we can obtain n cents out of coins of two values, 3 and 5. Okay. So it's kind of like a virtual example. There are no coins of 3 cents. But what this says is that any number greater than 8 can be represented as a sum of products of 3 and 5. So first thing we have to prove the base case. And the base case basically says that P of A must be true. And it's easy. You can actually you can represent 8 as 3 plus 5. So you need one coin of 3 and one coin of 5, and that represents 8, the sum 8. Then the inductive step. What we want to prove is that for all k greater than or equal with 8, if P of k is true, then P of k plus 1 is also true. So we start by assuming that the inductive hypothesis is true. That suppose that k is any particular arbitrary chosen integer greater than or equal with 8. P of k is that k is cents, can be obtained using 3 cent coins and 4 cent coins. So basically, we assume P of k to be true. And now we must show that P of k plus 1 is also true. P of k plus 1 is k plus 1 cents, can also be obtained out of 3 cent and 4 and 5 cent coins. Now, There are two cases. It's basically, we prove it by division into cases. Let's assume that there is a 5 cent coin used to make the used to make up the 3 cent the k cent coins for that value k. Now it's easy to see that if you take out that 5 cent coin and you replace it by 2 3 cent coins, you are basically getting k plus 1 cents. Okay, so basically, if there is at least 1 5 cent coin among the ones that made the k cent coin value, then you can basically get k plus 1 cents out of coins of 3 and 5 denominations. The case number two is that there are no 5 cent coins among those that make up the k cents. Like, for instance, for 9, you have 3 3-cent coins. Because one thing that you can observe is that for k greater than equal with 8, you need at least 3 coins to use. Because for 9, you need 3. And for anything bigger than 9, let's say 27, you need 9 such coins. So you have to use more than equal with 3 from 9 onwards. Therefore, you can replace those 3 3-cent coins, which are 9 cents, with 2 5-cent coins, which is 10 cents. And then you still get k plus 1 cents. So basically, for any k strictly greater than 9, if you don't have any 5 cent coins among the ones that you basically have to make the k cents, you basically need to have at least 3. And you can replace those 3 3-cent coins into 2 5-cent coins, and you are getting now k plus 1, because you increased with 1 cent the number. So basically, it divided into two possible cases. We have a 5 cent coin or we don't. In either case, we can represent the next k plus 1 number into a sum of two products, a product with 3 and the product with 5. So now we can actually see that this property goes to infinity, because it was true for p of 8, and it's true for that implication that if it was true for p of k implies p of k plus 1 for all integers greater than 8. Therefore, the original formula that we wanted to prove, that for any number greater than 8, it can be represented with 5 and 3 cent coins, is true. So this is mathematical induction. You basically prove it for a base case, and then you prove it that it propagates from one case to another to infinity. Okay. Let's see it for formulas, because it's easier to actually see it. So the sum of the first n integers can be actually represented by an explicit formula. So 1 plus 2 up to n is actually equal with n multiplied with n plus 1 divided by 2. Now let's assume that you don't know this for you don't know if this is true. You want to prove it for all integers n greater than equal with 1. So how do we do it? We basically prove it for the base case first. So we basically see that for n equal 1, we have 1 equal with 1 multiplied with 1 plus 1 divided by 2, which is true, because 1 multiplied with 2 divided by 2 is equal with 1. So base case is true. Excellent. Now the inductive step. We assume P of k to be true for any particular but arbitrary chosen k greater than equal with 1. So now we basically know that 1 plus 2 plus up to k is equal with k multiplied with k plus 1 divided by 2, our formula. Now we want to prove that P of k plus 1 is also true. What, first of all, what is P of k plus 1? We replace n with k plus 1 in this formula above that we want to prove. So that will be 1 plus 2 up to k plus 1 is equal with k plus 1 multiplied with k plus 2 divided by 2. Because we replace n with k plus 1, we get k plus 1, k plus 1 plus 1, which is k plus 2, divided by 2. Okay. So now we start from the left-hand side of this formula. And the left-hand side is the sum of all the numbers from 1 to k plus 1. That includes k. But we already know that P of k was true. So 1 plus 2 up to k is k multiplied with k plus 1 divided by 2. We replace that first part of the sum. It's like in recursion. We replace that part of the sum with the formula, explicit formula that we know for that expression. And now the entire left-hand side becomes k multiplied with k plus 1 divided by 2 plus k plus 1. In order to bring this to a single fraction, we basically have multiply and divide by 2 the second operand. So we get 2k plus 1 divided by 2. We reduce it to a single fraction is k multiplied with k plus 1 plus 2 multiplied with k plus 1. We give k plus 1 as a common factor, and we get k plus 1 multiplied with k plus 2 divided by 2, which is exactly the right-hand side of that formula. It's P of k plus 1. So we basically proved also P of k plus 1 starting from P of k being true. So this propagates to infinity. This sum is really true. The sum of the first n numbers is equal with n multiplied with n plus 1 divided by 2. It's also actually easy to see that this is true by grouping the first element with the last element. So we get n plus 1. The second element with the previous to the last element, it will be 2 plus n minus 1, which is n plus 1. And grouping n divided by 2 such pairs. Because the first one is n plus 1, the second such pair is n plus 1, and how many such pairs we have up to the middle. So it will be basically n multiplied with n plus 1 divided by 2. There is a story, a funny story, that actually Gauss knew this formula when he was 5. He was given in class a problem, compute the sum of the first 100 numbers, and immediately he raised his hand and he said, is 100 multiplied with 101 divided by 2. How do you apply it? You can apply it by bringing a sum, like for instance, the one that we have below, to that specific formula. So let's assume that somebody gives us 2 plus 4 plus 6 up to 500. So we know the explicit form of the inner element for this formula. We can actually bring it as 2 multiply with 1 plus 2 multiply with 2 plus 2 multiply with 3 up to 2 multiply with 250. Give 2 as a common factor. So now it will be 2 multiply with the sum from 1 to 250. We know that that sum is 250 multiplied with 251 divided by 2. Now we can reduce 2 with 2, and we get 250 multiplied with 251, which is easy to compute. It's 62,750. Similarly, if we are given a sum of such consecutive numbers, integers, but missing some elements at the beginning, we can actually do it by summing all of the elements from 1 to 50 and then subtracting the elements that were missing. So this will be 50 multiplied with 51 divided by 2 minus the sum of the elements from 1 to 4, which is 10, minus 10. Okay. So it's very, very easy in two steps to actually, or three steps to do such sums. I remember one time that I gave such a problem in an exam, in a midterm. And someone just started summing the numbers, 2 with 4 with 6 up to 50. That's not the right way to do it. It will take you hours to do it basically manually, instead of using the formula for the sum of the first n integers to compute it. Next type of special sequence that we know in mathematics are called geometric sequences. In geometric sequences, each term in the sequence is obtained from the preceding one by multiplying it with a constant factor. If the first term is 1 and the constant factor is r, then the geometric sequence is 1, r, r squared, r to the cube, up to r to the n, and so on. Now, the sum of such a geometric sequence will be 1 plus r squared plus up to r to the power n. So this is the sum from I equals 0 to n of r to the power I. And this is equal with the following formula, r to the power n plus 1 minus 1 divided by r plus 1. So this can be proven through induction, in fact. We'll assume it to be true for some k, and then we'll see that it's also true for k plus 1. So, base case. For the base case, we have to show that this is true for n equals 0. So in that case, basically, on the left-hand side, we have the summation notation, the sum of from I equals 0 to 0 of r to the power I. So we can actually see that this is only r to the power 0, which is 1. So this is 1. And the right-hand side is r to the power 0 plus 1 minus 1, which is r to the power 1 minus 1, which is r minus 1. You reduce the two terms and you get 1 on the left-hand side is equal with 1 on the right-hand side, which is true, proved. Now you have to prove the inductive step. So suppose in the inductive hypothesis that P of k is true for some k arbitrarily chosen greater than or equal with 0. So the sum from I equals 0 to k of r to the power I is equal with r to the power k plus 1 minus 1 divided by r minus 1. And now we want to prove that P of k plus 1 is also true, that the sum notation from I equals 0 to k plus 1 of r to the power I is equal with r to the power k plus 2. Basically, we replace n with k plus 1 and we get k plus 1 plus 1, which is k plus 2, minus 1 divided by r minus 1. So let's start from the left-hand side and expand it. So basically, the sum from I equals 0 to k plus 1 of r to the power I is 1 plus r squared up to r to the power k plus r to the power k plus 1. However, in the previous step, we assumed the inductive hypothesis to be true, that the sum from I equals 0 to k of r of I is r to the power k plus 1 minus 1 divided by r minus 1. So this sum is basically the first part recursively of that summation is that sum. So it's basically r to the power k plus 1 minus 1 divided by r minus 1. Now we have only the last term. We have to bring it to the same denominator. So basically, we multiply it with r minus 1, and we divide it with r minus 1. So we have the first formula plus r to the power k plus 1 multiplied with r is r to the power k plus 2 minus r to the power k plus 1 minus multiplied with minus 1 is basically r to the power k plus 1. So we have r to the power k plus 2 minus r to the power k plus 1 divided by r minus 1. Now, since these two fractions have the same denominator, we basically bring them into one fraction in which we have r to the power k plus 1 minus 1 plus r to the power k plus 2 minus r to the power k plus 1. R to the power k plus 1 minus r to the power k plus 1 is 0. And now we get r to the power k plus 2 minus 1 divided by r minus 1, which is exactly what we wanted to prove. Therefore, the original formula is true. This is the explicit formula for a geometric sequence. For all integers n greater than or equal with 0, the sum from 1 to r to the power n is r to the power n plus 1 minus 1 divided by r minus 1. Okay. So let's do a few examples. If somebody is asking you, what is 1 plus 3 plus 3 to the power 2 plus up to 3 to the power m minus 2? All that you basically have to do is to take the last term, 3 to the power m minus 2 plus 1 minus 1 divided by 3 minus 1, which is equal with 3 to the power m minus 1 minus 1 divided by 2. Similarly, if you have a geometric sequence and you see that you don't, we are not starting from 1 plus 3 plus the rest of the sequence, you can do it in two different ways, in fact. You can give 3 to the power 2 as a common factor. So we get 3 to the power 2 multiplied with 1 plus 3 plus 3 to the power 2 up to 3 to the power m minus 2. And now this is a geometric sequence. So it's 3 to the power m minus 2 plus 1, which is 3 to the power m minus 1, minus 1 divided by 3 minus 1, which is 2. Multiplied with 3 to the power 2, which is 9. Another way would have been to put the two terms at the beginning, 1 plus 3 plus 3 to the power 2 and so on, minus 1 plus 3. But that actually gives us about the same formula, so we'll basically, we can simplify it in the first form. Okay. Let's see if there are any questions. No. No new questions. Okay, so let's prove another property using mathematical induction. And this time we'll prove a divisibility property. So the property that we want to prove, P of n, is that for all integers n greater than or equal with 0, 2 to the power 2n minus 1 is divisible by 3. Now, one thing is to actually expand these values. So for n equals 0 is 2 to the power 0 minus 1 is 1 minus 1 is 0, and 0 is divisible by 3, because 3 multiplied with 0 is equal with 0. What about for n equal 1? 2 to the power 2 minus 1 is 3, and 3 is divisible by 3. 3 multiplied with 1 is 3. What about for n equal 2? 2 to the power 4 minus 1 is 2 to the power 4 is 16. Minus 1 is 15, so 15 is divisible by 3 is true, because 3 multiplied with 5 is 15, and so on. So we have a hunch, we have the intuition that this is true. 2 to the power 2n minus 1 is always divisible by 3, but we need to prove it for all n greater than or equal with 0, which is an infinite number of positive integers. So how do we do it? We prove the basic step first. So in our case, P of 0 is 2 to the power 2 multiplied with 0 minus 1, which we saw that is 2 to the power 0, which is 1, minus 1 is 0. And 0 was divisible by 3. We assume the inductive hypothesis to be true. That means, suppose that P of k is true for any k, for an arbitrary chosen k, greater than or equal with 0, which basically means that 2 to the power 2k minus 1 is divisible by 3. Now, prove that P of k plus 1 is also true. What is P of k plus 1? If we replace in the original formula 2 to the power 2n minus 1, k n equal 3, k plus 1, we get that 2 to the power 2k plus 1 minus 1 needs to be divisible by 3. So let's see how to prove that. So we start with 2 to the power 2 k plus 1 minus 1, and we expand it. This is equal with 2 to the power 2 k plus 2 minus 1 is divisible by 3. Okay, so now we have to expand this a little bit. So 2 to the power 2 k plus 2 is 2 to the power 2 k multiplied with 2 to the power 2 minus 1. 2 to the power 2 is 4. 4 can be written as 3 plus 1. So now we basically write that. Then we distribute multiplication over summation. So we get 2 to the power 2k multiplied with 3 plus 2 to the power 2k minus 1. But now, remember what was the original formula. The original formula that we had was 2 to the power 2k minus 1 was divisible by 3. We want to bring that in here. So basically we have 2 to the power 2k minus 1 is divisible by 3. By the inductive hypothesis, that can be rewritten as 3 multiplied with r, where r is an integer. And now we can give 3 as a common factor between these two operands of the summation. So this is equal with 3 multiplied with 2 to the power 2k plus r, which is an integer. Therefore, 2 to the power 2k plus 1 minus 1, the original formula, is divisible by 3 because it's equal with 3 multiplied with an integer. Therefore, the original property was true because basically we proved the base case and we proved that for any k greater than or equal with 0, if p of k is true, then p of k plus 1 is also true. So we propagated this property to infinity. Basically, we use that inductive hypothesis step in this place here, and then we actually prove the original formula that is true for k for k plus 1. So you see, one thing that I did here, and you also have to do in one of the problems in the homework, is that I took this number 4, and I knew that I have to prove that this property is true for divisible with 3. So I broke 4 into 3 plus 1. So now, after distribution of multiplication of the summation, we get a factor that is a product of 3 what with another integer. And the second part maps to our inductive hypothesis. So when we know that is also a multiple of 3. Therefore, we gave 3 as a common factor, and we found another multiple of 3, which proves basically the inductive step. Any questions? Okay, good. So as you can see, even if the formula is quite complicated, we can propagate it. We can propagate it by using induction to an infinite number of elements for all integers greater than or equal with 0 in our case. What about using mathematical induction to prove an inequality? So assume that we want to prove the following inequality. For all integers n greater than or equal with 3, 2 to the power 2 multiplied with n plus 1 is less than 2 to the power n. So again, we start with the base case. We want to prove for n equal 3, p of 3. So in that case, the left-hand side of this inequation becomes 2 multiplied with 3 plus 1, strictly less than 2 to the power 3, which is 7, strictly less than 8 is true. Now we want to prove the inductive step. So suppose that the property p of k is true for some particular k arbitrarily chosen, k in where k is greater than or equal with 3. So what we know to be true is that 2k plus 1 is strictly less than 2 to the power k. It's basically we replaced in the original property n with k. Now we have to prove that p of k plus 1 is also true in the inductive step. What is p of k plus 1? It's 2 multiplied with k plus 1. Plus 1 is less than 2 to the power k plus 1. we now start expanding. So we basically have to prove this, which is equivalent with proving 2k plus 3, because we distribute 2 over k plus 1. It's k plus 2k plus 2 plus 1, which is 2k plus 3, is strictly less than 2 to the power k plus 1. But 2k plus 3 can be rewritten as 2k plus 1 plus 2. Why? Because we want to bring it to the inductive hypothesis. So 2k plus 1 plus 2 is strictly less than the first factor is less than 2 to the power k. And the second one, 2, is less than also 2 to the power k for any k greater than 3. You get 2 less than 8, 2 less than 16. Always 2 to the power k for k greater than 3 is greater than 2. So the first operand is less than 2 to the power k by inductive hypothesis. And the second one can also be proven by induction, that 2 is less than 2 to the power k for all k. But we can see it directly from arithmetics that basically it's a true property. Now we have 2 to the power k plus 2 to the power k, which is 2 multiplied with 2 to the power k, which is 2 to the power k plus 1. So we just proved that 2 multiplied with k plus 1 plus 1 is less than 2 to the power k plus 1, which was basically what needed to be proven. Okay? That's basically the property that we wanted to prove. So again, the first thing that you would try when you have the case for P of K plus 1 is to bring the formula as close to as possible to the inductive hypothesis. Because that's why we rewrote 2K plus 3 as 2K plus 1 plus 2, because 2K plus 1 was the left-hand side of the inductive hypothesis P of K. So always try to rewrite. It's kind of like recursion. You try to rewrite the case of P of K plus 1 into the case of P of K. Okay. Next, let's consider the following sequence. A of 2 is equal with 2. A of 1 is equal with 2. And we have a recursive formula for A of K. A of K is 5 multiplied with A of K minus 1. And we want to prove, and this is true for all k greater than or equal with 2. So we have a recursive sequence. And now we want to prove the general explicit formula for A of n. A of n is equal with 2 multiplied with 5 to the power n minus 1 for all n greater than or equal with 1. So we want to prove by induction this property, basically that P of n is true for all integers n greater than or equal with 1. And again, we prove the base case, and then we prove the inductive step. The base step is that P of 1 is true for n equal 1. We can actually see that A of 1, by definition, was equal with 2. But by this formula, A of 1 will be 2 multiplied with 5 to the power 1 minus 1, which is 2 multiplied with 5 to the power 0. 5 to the power 0 is 1. So this is 2 multiplied with 1 is equal with 2, which is exactly our base case. The inductive hypothesis is assumed to be true for some particular k arbitrarily chosen. P of k will be that A of k is equal with 2 multiplied with 5 to the power k minus 1. And now we want to show that P of k plus 1 is also true. What is P of k plus 1? Is that A of k plus 1 is equal with 2 multiplied with 5 to the power k plus 1 minus 1, and which is basically that is 2 multiplied with 5 to the power k. So let's start with this formula, that A of k plus 1 is 5, the recursive formula, A of k plus 1 is basically 5 multiplied with A of k plus 1 minus 1. So basically we use the recursive formula for the sequence. But the index 5 plus 1 minus 1 is just k. K plus 1 minus 1 is just k. So really we have that 5 multiplied with a of k. By the inductive step, we know that a of k is 2 multiplied with 5 to the power k minus 1. So basically we can replace it and we get that a of k plus 1 is 5 multiplied with 2 multiplied with 5 to the power k minus 1. By associativity of multiplication and regrouping, we get that this is can be rewritten as 2 multiplied with 5 multiplied with 5 to the power k plus 1. 5 to the power k plus 1 multiplied with 5 is 5 to the power k. So therefore, a of k plus 1 is equal with 2 multiplied with 5 to the power k. And we did this by just using the inductive step and the definition, the recursive definition of a of k. And we reached that, yes, it's true, a of n k plus 1 is equal with 5 multiplied with 2 to the power 2 multiplied with 5 to the power k. Okay. So we always in the inductive step, we will try to use the inductive hypothesis to prove the next step, k plus 1. Oh, okay. There was a question for slide 34 and proving the case k plus 1. Is it not necessary to restate the condition for k greater than equal with 3 in the first sentence of the inference? But I see that you already figured it out. Oh, no, that's actually the explanation. Thank you very much, Dirac. Excellent. Good. So we proved inequalities, we proved explicit formulas for sequences using induction up to now. Let's wait to see if there are any other questions. I don't see other questions, so we can continue. Now let's prove a problem from Tetris. So Tetris is a game that was invented about 40 years ago. And it's really simple. You are given different shapes of trominos are these sequences or geometric shapes using squares. Like for instance, we are given two trominos, a line of three or an L shape. And we have to prove the following property. For any integer n strictly greater than equal than with 1, if one square is removed from a 2 to the power n by 2 to the power n checkerboard, the remainder squares can be completed, completely covered by L-shaped trominos. So here we have an example. For instance, I give you a 2 by 2 checkerboard, I can eliminate any one of the four cells. You can still cover it with an L-shaped tromino. And similarly, I can give you any 4x4, 16x16, and so on. Basically, 2 to the power n by 2 to the power n checkerboard, and eliminate any square, any one square. You can cover the rest with L-shaped trominos. So we want to prove this property, this geometric property, using induction. So first of all, the base case is clear. For n equal 1, we can cover any one, we can eliminate any one cell, and we can cover it with an L-shape that covers the rest of the tree. Okay. So the base case is immediate. The inductive hypothesis says the following. If you give me basically any 2 to the power k by 2 to the power k checkerboard, and you eliminate one square anywhere in that tromino, I can come, I can in that checkerboard, I can cover the rest with L-shaped dominoes. So now you have to prove the property for any k plus one. What is a k? What's the k plus one checkerboard? It's a 2 to the power k plus 1 by 2 to the power k plus 1. So we have basically 3 quarters of 2 to the power k. The property says if I eliminate any cell from any one of the 3 of the 4 quarters, so I can eliminate it from the first one, or I can eliminate it from the second one, or from the third one, or from the fourth one, then you can still cover the rest, all the rest except that one square that you removed, with L-shaped of 3 trominos. And it's actually immediate out of the inductive hypothesis, because let's say that I eliminated the square from the first quarter. Now I can, by the inductive hypothesis, I can eliminate the rest, I can cover the rest with L-shaped trominos. But now I can put a tromino that covers the corners, the lower left corner of the second quarter, the upper right corner of the third quarter, and the upper left corner of the last quarter with one tromino. But now by the inductive hypothesis, each one of these three other quarters can be covered with L-shaped trominos because they are of size 2 to the power k by 2 to the power k, and we eliminated one square of each. So therefore, a 2 to the power k plus 1 by 2 to the power k plus 1 checkerboard can also be covered with L-shaped trominos if we eliminate one square. And this is actually the whole idea of Tetris, that you can never finish, that no matter how you get these trominos of L-shaped, you basically still have something left that you basically have to cover, okay? I don't know if you played the game. It's a very classical game. Most of you, if not all, must have played it before. You have basically falling trominos, and every time you complete a line, it disappears. But this property actually tells you that you cannot get to a case that you basically you have no leftover trominos. Okay, so before we continue with strong mathematical induction, let's see if there are any questions. Yes. Now, so Alyssa, you are right. Drawing such a diagram like the one that I did, it's good enough. In fact, you will see that many other problems, for instance, set theory, we will learn about Venn diagrams, and you will have to draw such figures. But first of all, you can see that, yes, although we are learning these topics, we cannot test it in an online exam because we have only text areas that you can only use your keyboard to write the solution. So don't expect any problems with trominos in the midterm or the final, just in the midterm, because the final and the midterm 2 are independent, or midterm 1 are independent. So these kind of problems are very interesting, but we can't administer them in an exam. Okay, so strong mathematical induction. So the principle of strong mathematical induction, or also called the complete induction, is again that we want to prove a property Pn for all integers n, but we start with a and b as fixed integers, such as a is less than or equal with b. Now, in this principle, instead of starting with one base case and then proving the inductive step based on one previous step, this is a little bit more complicated. We basically have to prove in the base case that for P of A, P of A plus 1 up to P of B are all true. So basically, you prove all of the cases between A and B inclusive. And then in the inductive step, you prove that for any integer greater k greater than equal with b, if p of I is true for all integers from I to k, so the inductive hypothesis is not only the previous step p of k, but is all of the steps prior to k, then p of k plus 1 is also true. Then the statement for all integers n greater than a p of n is true, is true. So the valid logic argument is actually a little bit more complex. Given that p of a plus 1 out of p of b up to p of b are true, and for all integers k greater than equal with b, and for all integers I greater than equal with A and less than equal with K, P of I implies P of I is true. All of this implies P of K plus 1 is true. So from the previous K steps, we can prove the next step K plus 1. And this is true for all K greater than equal with B, the upper limit of the base cases. Then P of N must be true for all n greater than equal with a. Okay, so let me draw it because it's a little bit more difficult. So in the basic mathematical induction, let's increase the size. So this is induction, the basic one. We basically, let's say that we have some real axis, okay? So actually, let me draw it. It's much easier. So let's assume that we want to prove a property that some P of N is true for all N greater than equal with some a. Okay. So you have the real axis, no? Basically, all the integers from 1 to infinity, or basically from some value to infinity, and you had some somewhere here. Maybe we put a little circle. Somewhere here, you have A. Okay. Now, what we do in mathematical induction, we prove that the property is true for P of A. So P of A is true. And then we prove that for any K that may be somewhere later, like maybe it's here. Okay. So somewhere here, we have a k. And this lowercase k is greater than equal with a. And we are proving that if p of k is true, then p of k plus 1 is also true. So if it was true for P of A, and in any case, for any K greater than A, greater than equal with A, P of K implies P of K plus 1, it's true to infinity. Because from A, it propagates to A plus 1, then to A plus 2, then to A plus 3, and so on to infinity. So now, what exactly does strong induction do, if this is what normal induction or basic induction does? So let's consider the case of strong induction. So let me zoom down a little bit. Oops. So strong induction does the following. Again, we have some real axis, so we'll make it a little bit longer. It's easier to actually see. And somewhere we have a value a, and later, maybe after many steps, we have a value b. Now the basic step says prove all of the properties for p of a, or p of a plus one, and prove all of them up to b. Okay, p of b included. Now, for any k, so somewhere k is here, yeah? And k is basically, let me also write that is greater than or equal with b. So for any such k, we basically consider that for all previous cases, so for all i's, and let's put that I is A is less than equal with I, and I is less than equal with B, with K actually. The property P of I is true. So we basically assume all of the previous cases to be true. It's not only we consider that P of B is true, but everything before P of B, all of these are true. Then we show that this actually implies P of K plus one. So instead of using just one case, just we assume everything before k is true, and we use them to prove p of k plus one. So we actually use it to prove the next case. In fact, these two methodologies, induction or basic induction and strong induction, are equivalent. Because the first one, what does it say? It basically says that p of a was true, and for some k, p of k was true implies p of k plus one. But why would p of k be true if it does imply p of k plus one? Everything before k was true. So it really means that all of the previous cases up to k are true, and that can be used to prove p of k plus one. So you can think of induction as a special case of strong induction. But you don't have to, because there are problems that are easier to solve with induction, pure basic induction. And there are problems, like for instance, we will see next that every number is divisible by a prime number, which are more natural to be solved with strong induction. You consider all of the previous cases up to k to be true, and then you use that to prove p of k plus one. So really the difference between the two is that in one of them, you use only P of K to prove P of K plus one. In the other one, you consider all the cases up to P of K to be true, and you use that to prove P of K plus one. But the two are equivalent with each other. In fact, I can take any property and prove that if it's true by strong induction, it's also true by induction, and vice versa. If it's true by induction, is also true by strong induction. Actually, as I said, it's actually a very easy one, because you would only use P of K to prove the next step. You don't need to consider all of the previous ones. So that's actually the difference between strong induction and induction. In case of induction, you would use only the case P of K to be true, to prove P of K plus one. In the case of strong induction, you assume all of the cases before k were true to prove p of k plus one. But you have to write it explicitly to show that this is what you're doing. Okay. Okay. So let's actually see an example, and that will clarify what we are doing here. So again, just remind one more time what's the valid logical argument of strong mathematical induction. You prove in the base case that P of A, P of A plus 1, P of up to P of B are all true. And then for any K arbitrarily chosen greater than equal with B, if for all I's such that I is greater than equal with A and less than equal with K, P of I's are true, then P of K plus 1 is also true. Therefore, P of N is true for all N greater than equal with A. Okay. So as I said, any statement that can be proven with ordinary mathematical induction can be actually proven with strong mathematical induction, but we only use the last step, and vice versa. Anything that can be proven with strong mathematical induction through a transformation can be proven by mathematical induction. But in this case, in this class, we are only going to prove statements. So we don't have to actually prove this theorem in general. Okay. So let's see an example of strong mathematical induction. We want to prove the divisibility by primes. Any integer greater than 1 is divisible by a prime number. So the property P of n is that n is divisible by a prime number for all n greater than 1, strictly greater than 1. So what's the base case? In this case, we still have a single base case, P of 2. 2 is divisible by a prime number. And that's true, because 2 is divisible by 2, and 2 is a prime number. Next, we have the inductive hypothesis. Let k be any integer such that k is greater than or equal with 2. Now, for all i's that are less than or equal with k, p of I is that I is divisible by a prime number. And this is true for all integers. Let me actually write. It's actually written p of I is true for all integers I from 2 to k. In fact, for all integers, let's write it here. I greater than equal with 2. Let's write it explicitly. 2 less than I, and I is less than equal with k. So we assume that to be true. We basically, P of I is true for all such integers from 2 to k. And now in strong mathematical induction, we have to show that P of k plus 1 is also true. And P of k plus 1 being that k plus 1 is divisible by a prime number. So now there are two possible cases. Last time we learned number theory, and for every integer, it can be prime or not prime. So if k plus 1 is prime, then k plus 1 is divisible by itself. K plus 1 is k plus 1 multiplied with the integer 1. Therefore, the k plus 1 is divisible by a prime number. The second case is that k plus 1 is not a prime, which means that it is a composite number. So k plus 1 can be written as the product of two integers, a and b, where a and b are a is strictly greater than 1 and strictly less than k plus 1. And b is strictly greater than 1 and strictly less than k plus 1. But from the fact that k plus 1 is equal with a multiplied with b, and a is less than k plus 1, by the inductive hypothesis, it must be the case that a is divisible by a prime number. By definition of that, is that a is equal with a prime number p multiplied with an integer. By transitivity of divisibility, k plus 1 will be divisible by the prime number p. So k plus 1 is also divisible by a prime number. Okay, we don't need to actually make this assumption. We can just say that therefore, by definition of divisibility, A can be written as P multiplied with some number, let's say J, where J is an integer. So A plus 1 will be equal with P multiplied with J multiplied with B. But we can group J and B multiply. So this will be equal with P multiplied with the product of J multiplied with B. Therefore, K plus 1 is divisible by P. So that's basically K plus 1 is divisible by a prime number, which is P, which was exactly what we wanted to prove. That's it. Okay. And this is an example of strong mathematical induction. We don't actually have to have a specific case right before K plus 1. We can choose all the cases up to K plus 1 to be true, not including K plus 1. Another example of strong mathematical induction. So let's consider the following recursively defined sequence. So we have S of 0 is equal with 0, S of 1 is equal with 4, and S of k is equal with 6 multiplied with S of k minus 1, minus 5 multiplied with S of k minus 2, for all integers k greater than or equal with 2. Let's expand it a bit to see what happens for S of 2, S of 3, and so on. So S of 2 will be 6 multiplied with S of 1 plus 5 multiplied with S of 0, because basically we have for k equal 2, you replace k in the general formula and you get k minus 1 is basically 2 minus 1 is 1, and k minus 2 is 2 minus 2 is 0. Now, S of 2 becomes 6 multiplied with S of 1, which is 4, 6 multiplied with 4, and minus 5 multiplied with S of 0, 5 multiplied with 0 is 24. S of 3 will be 6 multiplied with S of 2 minus 5 multiplied with S of 1, which is basically 6 multiplied with 24 minus 5 multiplied with 4, which is 124. We want to prove that S of n can be explicitly written as 5 to the power n minus 1. Now, we take a look at the previous cases. Is it true for 0? Yes, 5 to the power 0 is 1, minus 1 is 0. So this general formula is true for S of 0. What about for S of 1? 5 to the power 1 minus 1 is 5, minus 1 is 4. Yes, it's true for S of 1. What about for 2? S of 2 will be 5 to the power 2 minus 1, 25 minus 1, 24. It's true. What about for 3? 5 to the power 3 is 125, minus 1 is 124. So this formula is true for the cases 0, 1, 2, and 3. But we want to prove it in general for any k greater than or equal with 2, and we cannot expand it to infinity. So we start by using strong mathematical induction. So the base cases were that P of 0 and P of 1 were true. So we were given those two values, and we actually see, we saw that S of 0 can be written as 5 to the power 0 minus 1, which is 1 minus 1 is 0, and that was exactly what S of 0 was. S of 1 is 5 to the power 1 minus 1 by this formula, which is equal with 5 minus 1, which is equal with 4, which is exactly what S of 1 was given to us to be. So now we assume to be true the inductive hypothesis, and that is that let k be any integer greater than or equal with 1. And S of I, for any I greater than or equal with 0 and less than or equal with k, is that S of I is 5 to the power I minus 1. Now we want to prove that P of k plus 1 is also true. That is that S of k plus 1 is 5 to the power k plus 1 minus 1. So we start with the recursive formula. S of k plus 1 was 6 multiplied with S of k minus 5 multiplied with S of k minus 1. By the inductive hypothesis, S of k is 5 to the power k minus 1, and S of k minus 1 is 5 to the power k minus 1 minus 1. So now we replace both of those terms, and we expand the we distribute multiplication over subtraction in both cases. So we get 6, 5k minus 6 minus 5 to the power k plus 5. We see that minus 6 plus 5 is minus 1. And we can give 5k as a common factor, and we get 6 minus 1 multiplied with 5k is 5 to the power 5 multiplied with 5 to the power k minus 1. And 5 multiplied with 5 to the power k is 5 to the power 5k plus 1 is 5 to the power k plus 1 minus 1. And that's exactly what we need to prove. So you see that we didn't use only one step in the previous from the previous set of steps. We use two steps in the back to prove the current case. So basically it's strong mathematical induction. We proved it for two steps in the base case, and then we proved it for any k greater than 1, basically greater than equal with the second case. And we used the previous two steps to prove the current step. So it's basically we used more than just the last step to prove the current step. So it's strong mathematical induction. Okay. And similarly, we can use the strong mathematical induction to prove to multiply any n numbers is you need n minus 1 multiplications. So basically what I'm saying here is that if you have a set of numbers that you want to multiply, like for instance 34 multiplied with 51 multiplied with 43 and so on, you can compute this in multiple ways. You can basically do the first multiplication and then the second multiplication, or you can do the second multiplication through associativity of multiplication and then do the first one. But it doesn't matter how you do these multiplications, how you group the operands from the middle, from the left-hand side, from the right-hand side. In the end, you need the number of terms that you want to multiply minus one multiplications to execute. So we will need, in this case, no matter how you group them, two multiplications. So in order to multiply n terms, you need to execute n minus one multiplications, binary multiplications, those that you have two terms and you multiply them. So this is exactly what this property says. To multiply n numbers, you need to execute n minus 1 multiplications. Okay? And it's very easy to do. Basically, the property that we want to prove is that we have some n numbers, x1, x2, xn. And no matter how you put the parentheses in this product to execute binary multiplications, the number of multiplications that you need to compute is n minus 1. So let's start with the base case. Let's assume that it's a single number, x1. How many multiplications you need? None. Let's see, the formula says that you subtract from the number of terms 1 and you get 0. So yeah, if you are given a single number, you don't need to do any multiplication, you get it. Similarly, if you want to show another step, how many multiplications you need for two terms, one multiplication. So the base case is kind of simple. If you have one or two terms, you basically can compute the number of multiplication is immediate. The inductive hypothesis, let k be any integer with k greater than or equal with 1. And for all integers I from 1 to k, if x1 to xi are numbers, then no matter how you put the parentheses into the product, the number of multiplications used to compute the product is I minus 1. So you consider a number k, and you know that for any subset of that number k, basically for any I less than equal with k, you need I minus 1 multiplications to compute the product. So now let's consider the case of k plus 1. Let's consider that we have x1, x2 up to xk plus 1 terms, and you want to compute their multiplications, no matter how you basically put the parentheses around the terms. The property p of k plus 1 tells you that you need k plus 1 minus 1 multiplications to execute. So let's assume that you find the most efficient way to put the parentheses. So you compute the products up to the last multiplication. So the last multiplication is a multiplication of two terms, where the first term was the product of some of the terms, like from x1 to xi, and the rest of the terms is the product of the terms from xi minus 1, xi plus 1 to xk plus 1. In order to execute the left-hand side product and then the right-hand side product, you need L and you need R multiplications. By inductive hypothesis, for the left-hand side product, you have L minus 1 multiplications. Also, by inductive hypothesis, for the right product, you have R minus 1 multiplications. For the last multiplication, you have one more multiplication. So we have L minus 1 plus R minus 1 plus 1 multiplications. However, if the number of terms on the left-hand side was L and the number of terms on the right-hand side was R, the total number of terms is K plus 1. So L plus R is K plus 1 number of terms that you wanted to multiply in the first place. Minus 1, it will be K plus 1 minus 1 is equal with K. So basically to execute, to multiply K plus 1 elements, you need K multiplications. So no matter how you group, you have in the end a left-hand side and the right-hand side that you need to multiply. The size of the number of operands that you have in the left-hand side is L. Therefore, you execute it internally, L minus 1 multiplications. The size of the right-hand side that you want to multiply is R. So you execute it internally, R minus 1 multiplications. You put them together by multiplying one more time, and you get k plus 1 minus 1, which is k multiplications, which proves basically a number of multiplications that you need to multiply k plus 1 numbers. Let's see if there are any questions.
Can you hear me?
Yes, please.
I want to ask, like, since we already like assume P of K is true in the induction hypothesis step, can we just like say that since P of K is true and
excellent point. So as I said before, you can't directly assume, but actually induction is equivalent with strong induction. So what's the problem? The problem is that we have a sequence, a x1, x2, x3, and so on, up to some many steps, xk plus one. Okay. Now, oops, let me zoom down. Where is it? That formula. Oops, here. Okay. So you didn't know how did we group this? Because one possible grouping is to group everything up to k plus one. No. However, we can't state that that is the optimal way to create, to do these multiplications. Maybe there is another way to multiply, maybe up to this here, and then the rest of the terms. So really, in order to find out how many multiplications you need in the optimum case to multiply these this entire product, you need to consider all possible such such ways to multiply. So it could be that you multiply up to here, somewhere in the middle, and then up to here. So you don't consider basically the case that you multiplied up to k plus one. You consider that maybe there is any possible way to multiply, how many ways you need, how many minimum number you need of multiplications you have to execute to multiply k plus one elements. And this maps perfectly to strong induction, because we assume that up to k, we had for any previous case, L, R, and so on, we needed that number of terms minus one multiplications. And that falls perfectly in mathematical induction, because now I know that if I have L terms here, in order to multiply them, I need L minus one multiplications. If I have R terms in the second part, in order to multiply them, I need R minus one multiplications. And in the end, I need one more multiplication to multiply the left-hand side with the right-hand side. So it's L minus one plus R minus one plus one. But L plus R, if these are L terms and these are R terms, is K plus one. So this will be k plus 1 minus 1, which is k number of multiplications to execute this entire multiplication. So it matches perfectly strong mathematical induction. Now, one thing that I told you from the beginning is that, in fact, these two methodologies are equivalent. However, you can't. It's easier sometimes to use strong mathematical induction for a special case. So you can see, I'm not going to prove it because it's a very long proof, but actually they are equivalent, because in the case that you have basic induction, you proved P of A, and you assume that for any possible K greater than or equal with A, P of K implies P of K plus one, and you want to prove P of K plus one. But really, if this was true, it was true for all of the elements up to k, because P of A was true, which implies that P of A plus 1 is true, which implies by the same formula that P of A plus 2 is true, and so on. So really, basic induction is the same with strong induction, because we assume all of the cases before k were true in order to prove P of K plus 1. But we don't state it explicitly. So the advantage of strong mathematical induction is that it's easier to apply for some problems.
Yes, thank you.
Welcome. And I think there was another question in the chat. Let me see what How many previous cases you are supposed to prove for the strong mathematical induction? Very good question. How many you need? So, for instance, we had this case, this sequence. So you wanted, you needed to, how many cases you needed to prove this universal formula? Because in the recursive relation, you have two steps back. So you need the previous two elements to prove the next element. You basically need to prove in the base case two cases. So that's why we have P of zero and P of one. Because you need at least two to prove the next case, to prove the inductive step. You see? So in order to use the recursion, the recursive formula. So in for this kind of problems, when you are given a recursive sequence and you need to prove an explicit formula for that recursive sequence, the number of steps that you have to use for the recursion to look back is tells you how many base steps you have. Okay? For other types of problems, like for instance, this one for the number of multiplications or for the number of prime numbers, you basically can already see from the induction that you don't need more than one step because basically you had it for P of one and that's more than enough because the inductive form, the inductive step is just considering all the previous steps. So you don't have to consider at least two or at least three or some number of at least number of elements to look back. So the advantage is that you need one and you don't need more than one. But I won't deduct points if I see that in your proof you used more than one, okay? Because I basically understand that even I need in many cases to expand a little bit. But in the base case, I can immediately identify from special the special problem that I need to implement how many minimum number of steps I need in the base case to use that recursion to basically prove the rest of the proof. So for this type of problems, you see from the recursive formula. For other type of problems, like for instance, the number of multiplications, you take the minimum, which in this case is exactly one. Okay. And the other case is basically just arithmetics. So I will leave it to you. I think each one you responded well. Yes, it's the correct response. Okay, let's see if there are any other questions. And since there are none, let's continue. Okay, so now we continue with strong mathematical induction to prove the existence and the uniqueness of any a binary integer representation for any positive integer. This is a little bit harder problem. For those of you that took CSE 114, Computer Science 1, a parallel course that can be taken concurrently or prior to Foundations of Computer Science, you know what is a binary representation in number systems of a positive integer in decimal. So basically what it is, it's a binary representation in the number system with base 2 of any decimal number. So basically the way that we transform from binary to decimal is that you take the digit, let's say the digits are CR, CR minus 1 up to C0, and you multiply it with powers of 2, starting with 0 as the index of the right-hand side digit, binary digit, or binary character, and then incrementing with 1 to the left. So basically, if you are given a binary number CR, CR minus 1 up to C0, you multiply CR with 2 to the power R plus CR minus 1 with 2 to the power R minus 1 plus up to C0, multiply with 2 to the power 0, which is 1. So really, this is just C0. Now, this is a little bit complicated, and I promise you that I will not give you these binary representations in the midterm too. But I will tell you what exactly, how you prove the existence of binary representations for any positive integer. And there are two proofs. There is the proof of existence and the proof of uniqueness. And we start with the proof of existence. You want to prove that any number can be represented in binary. So you start with 1. 1 can be represented as C0 to the power 2 to the power 0 if C0 is 1 and R is equal with 0. So basically it's 1 multiplied with 2 to the power 0, which is 1. The inductive hypothesis is that any integer k, for any integer k, for all integers from I to from 1 to k, P of I can be represented as a binary number. CR multiplied with 2 to the power R plus CR minus 1 multiplied with 2 to the power R minus 1 and so on. Now we have to show that K plus 1 can also be written in that required form as a binary number. Now there are two possible cases. K plus 1 can be integer that is even, and K plus 1 can be an integer that is odd. If k plus 1 is even, then k plus 1 divided by 2 is also an integer. And by inductive hypothesis, any integer less than k can be written in that form. So k plus 1 divided by 2 can be written as some CR multiplied with 2 to the power r plus CR minus 1 multiplied with 2 to the power r minus 1 up to C0. We multiply this equation with 2. So now we get that k plus 1 can be written as CR multiplied with 2 to the power k plus r plus 1 plus CR minus 1 multiplied with 2 to the power r plus up to C0 multiplied with 2 plus 0. But this is actually that representation, because the last term is really 0 multiplied with 2 to the power 0. So if the number is even, it can be represented in binary. And that binary representation is CR, CR minus 1, up to 0. If the number is odd, that basically means that is some integer k, actually some integer, let's call it j, plus 1. Basically that k is even, so k plus k divided by 2 is an integer, and we add 1 to that. But from the fact that k divided by 2 is even, we get a binary representation for k divided by 2. Because for any number less than k plus 1, it has a binary representation by inductive hypothesis. If we multiply this with 2, we are getting that k is equal with CR multiplied with 2 to the power r plus 1 up to C0 multiplied with 2. Therefore, if we add in this equation both sides with 1, k plus 1 is CR multiplied with 2 to the power r plus 1 plus up to 1. But this is actually a binary representation where the last digit is 1. So if we know that all of the prior numbers to k plus 1 can be represented in binary, by division into possible two cases, the single two possible two cases, k plus 1 can also be represented as a binary number. So any decimal number can be represented as a binary number. Now, there is one and only one representation for such numbers. And we are going to prove it by contradiction. Suppose that there are two binary representations for some integer n, different summations. So 2 to the power r plus CR minus 1 multiplied with 2 to the power r minus 1 and so on up to C0. And there is a second representation, maybe for a different index s, that is 2 to the power s plus a decimal multiply with 2 to the power s minus 1 up to t of 0. Now, first assumption is that r is less than s. If r is less than s, then the right-hand side is always less, it's less than basically if we put 1 for every digit. So basically, the left-hand side is always less than if we put instead of these CIs can be 0 or 1. If we put them 1, then basically we get that this sum is less than, is greater than the left-hand side. However, we have seen this sum today. It's a geometrical sequence. It's 1 plus 2 up to 2 to the power r. But this geometrical sequence is equal with 2 to the power r plus 1 minus 1 divided by 2 minus 1. But 2 minus 1 is 1. So the denominator is 1. Therefore, the numerator is actually what the number is. It's 2 to the power r plus 1 minus 1. But if r is strictly less than s, then 2 to the power s is greater than 2 to the power r plus 1 minus 1. Because even if r was the prior number to s, if you subtract from 2 to the power s 1, it's less than 2 to the power s. Now, since the first element of this right-hand side was 2 to the power s, and everything else following is 0 or 1, so it's basically a positive number, positive or 0, then the right-hand side is greater than the left-hand side. So they cannot be equal. So our assumption that there are two possible representations, binary representations for the same number, leads to a contradiction. That's the proof of uniqueness. But as I said, this is quite, you need to know binary representations, and I will not get into number systems in this class. It's just for those of you that took 214, 114, CSE 114, CS1. Okay, good. Before we move to recursion, which actually we did cover a little bit, let's see if there are any questions. So the question is basically related to the previous problem, that how do you represent k plus 1? Joyce replied very correctly. Okay, recursion. So we said, actually we showed in previous slides that a sequence can be defined in three different ways. You enumerate the elements of the sequence, you give a general pattern or explicit formula, like a of n is equal minus 1 to the power n multiplied with n plus 1 for all integers n greater than or equal with 1. Or you define it through a recursion. A of 1 is equal with minus 2. And a of n is equal with minus 1 to the power n minus 1 multiplied with a of n minus 1 plus minus 1 to the power n for all n that follow basically 1. So in fact, let me actually write it explicitly that this is true. Where is my mouse? My mouse disappeared. Okay, let me just copy it without the mouse. So this is true for all elements that followed 1. So in fact, all n greater than or equal with 2. Okay. Save. Let's return back to the slides. So recursion is a third way to define sequences. Basically, you define one or more initial values for the sequence, and then you define each later term by referring to an earlier term. We call such a relation a recurrence relation for a sequence A0 to A1, A2, infinity. Is a formula that relates each term A of K to a certain set of the predecessors, which are a of k minus 1, a of k minus 2, and so on. The initial conditions for such a recurrence relation specify the values of a of 0 to a of I minus 1 for some I, a fixed integer, or a of 0 to a of m, where m is an integer greater than equal with 0 if I depends on k. So basically, we already saw this in a couple of examples, that you can give a couple of the initial conditions, C0, C1, and then you give the recurrence relation, which computes the elements based on the previous steps. So for instance, if I would need to compute C of 2, that would be C of 1 plus 2 multiplied with C of 0 plus 1, which will be 2 plus 2 multiplied with 1 plus 1, which is 5. And similarly, if you substitute k in this formula with 3, it will give you 12. If you substitute it with 4, it will give you 33. Now, you can write the same recurrence relation in more than one way. And this is related to what we saw before as change of variable for summation notations. So you basically change from one range for every k greater than equal with 1 to some other range for k greater than equal with 0. This is kind of like change the limit. So we started with S0 is equal, the first term is equal with 1. And one recurrence relation defines S of k as is equal with 3 multiplied with S of k minus 1 minus 1 for all k greater than equal with 1. Another relation could be that actually S of minus 1 is equal with 1. And then S of k plus 1 is S3 of multiplied with S of k minus 1 for all integers k greater than equal with 0. So really, we have two different recurrence relations. And let me actually write them properly, because basically they are not quite defined properly, because the base step in the first case is S of 0. And the base step in the second case should be before 0, no? Because we need it. So S of minus 1 is given. And then you basically need the next step, no? So I just modified it a little bit so it fits better our cases. But both of these recurrence relations are actually defining the same sequence, okay? But recursively. Any questions? No. Okay, good. So these are two sequences where the initial relation is the same. And then we have two recurrent relations. One that defines that a of k is equal with 3 multiplied with a of k minus 1. And b of k is equal with 3 multiplied with b of k minus 1 for all integers k greater than or equal with b. So they actually have the same formula, but we can see that a of 1 starts from 2 and b of 1 starts from 1. So for a of 1, let's put it in the same line, and later we'll put b of k, b of 1. We basically have, in the first sequence, we have 2 followed by 6, 18, 54. In the second sequence, we only modify the first term, but we have a different sequence. We have 1, 3, 9, 27. So even if the recurrence relation is the same, the sequence is different because we have a different base case. The initial condition is different. Okay. So let's continue. So one of the most important sequences in mathematics is called Fibonacci numbers. It was invented by Leonardo di Pisa, a mathematician in the, I believe, 12th century, which basically posted the following property. We have one pair of rabbits, male and female, at the beginning of the year. And rabbits are not fertile during the first month of life, so therefore they give birth to a new pair of and afterwards they give birth to a new pair of rabbits, male and female, at the end of the first month. Next, we can define how many rabbits we have after any number of months, k. So you can see the base case, you started with one pair. In the next month, you also have one pair because they are not fertile in the first month. But after 2 months, you have the original pair, one, plus the one that got born in that month. So 1 + 1 = 2. Next month, we have the two pairs that we already have, and only the original pair gives birth to another pair of rabbits. So we have two current existing pairs plus another one, 3 pairs of rabbits. In the following month, we have 2 pairs of rabbits that were born in the 2 months prior to the current month, plus another pair of rabbits, so 3 pairs of rabbits, but only the first two give birth to another pair of rabbits. So 3 + 2 = 5 pairs of rabbits. And the process continues like this. Basically, the number of rabbit pairs alive at the end of the month k is the number of rabbits alive at the end of the month k minus 1 plus the number of rabbits pairs of rabbits born at the end of the month k. So at the end of every month, we have the current pairs of rabbits plus the number of pairs of rabbits that were alive in the previous month give birth to another set of the same number of pairs of rabbits. So really, if we write this as a sequence, we start with one f of 0 is equal with 1. Then we infer that f of 1 is also equal with 1. And then we have the recurrence formula that says that f of n is f of n minus 1 plus f of n minus 2 for all integers that follows k greater than equal with 2. And now we can actually compute based on this formula how many rabbits we have after each month. So in the first 2 months, we have 1. And then we have 1 + 1 = 2, 1 + 2 = 3, 2 + 3 = 5, 3 + 5 = 8, and so on. At the end of 1 year, we will have 89 plus 144, 233 pairs of rabbits. So within 1 year, we can get from one pair of rabbits, theoretically, to 233 pairs of rabbits. And this sequence is extremely important because, in fact, it's very used by Mother Nature. It's extremely common in nature. If you look at the petals of certain flowers, because of this way to propagate, of basically life, you can actually see that the number of petals that you have at the next level is equal in many cases to the number of petals that you had in the previous level plus the number of petals that you have in the previous to the previous level. Okay, so it's very, very common sequence that you have in nature. Now, the story goes, it's a funny story, that Fibonacci told his wife that at the end of the year they will become rich if they start with a pair of rabbits. But also the story goes that Fibonacci, Leonardo de Pisa, died in a poor's house. So his economic plan didn't actually work. It's a nice story, but really, it stands because of the mathematical proof and the mathematical sequence, not because of any economical reason. Okay, similarly, you can take the same idea of recursion and apply it in banking. So what is compound interest? Compound interest is the fact that you can earn at the end of the year for following years interest on the interest that you already earned in the previous year. So let's say that you start at the beginning of an year with 100,000 in a savings account. And This is an excellent bank that gives 4% interest compounded annually. The amount of the account at the end of any particular year is the amount of the in the account at the end of the previous year plus the interest that you earned on the account during the, that year. So the amount in the account at the end of the previous year plus 0.04 multiplied with the amount of the account at the end of the previous year. So you started with A0 100,000, and the recurrence relation is that A of K is equal with A of K minus 1 plus 0.04 multiplied with A of K minus 1, which is basically if you give A of K minus 1 as a common factor, is 1.04 multiplied with A of K minus 1 for every integer K greater than or equal with 1. So A of 0 was 100K, and you can actually see now that using the recursive formula, A of 1 will be equal with 104K at the end of the first year. Now you use that amount for A of 2 after 2 years. In the account, you will have $160, which is greater than $108,000. So you have an additional $160. This is compound interest. So this is why saving for retirement works, because you are not only earning interest, you are earning also interest on the interest that you have in the bank. So you will have a higher interest, or basically increase than the interest at the end of 10 years or 20 years or 50 years or 35 years. Okay. So compound interest is an example of a recursive relation. Now, if you also divide this by a number of months, so usually interest is not given, compounded at the end of 1 year, unless you have a certified deposit account. In that case, you will basically only earn that interest at the end of the period. But other than that, you usually earn interest at the end of each month, so multiple times per year, or at the end of each quarter. So really the same formula that we applied before can be actually divided quarterly, which you see that the although the interest per year is 3%, you actually make a little bit more as the compound interest if it's compound quarterly. You actually get an additional percentage as part of the interest. Okay. So for instance, let's assume that we have $100,000 compound computed at 3% compounded quarterly, 3% per year compounded quarterly. But 3% per year really means that within one quarter, you are earning 0.0075% as quarterly interest. So at the end of the, at the beginning of the period, you have $10,000 in the account. After one quarter of the year, you have $10,075 in the account. We just use the interest for the first quarter. But after the second quarter, you get also interest on the $75 that was the interest in the first month. So at the after the second quarter, you have $10,150.56. This is actually the interest on the $75. And this continues. After another quarter, you get this sum. After another quarter, you get this sum. So now you can actually see what would have, what is actually what is called the annual percentage rate. Not the actual compound, the interest 3%, but actually how much you make at the end of 1 year as an additional number. So you see that is actually 0.03034. which is a compound interest, it's an annual percentage rate, APR, of 3.034%. Okay. It's again a recurrence relation. In case that some problems like this come in the exam, I will actually give you the periods, and you can look at it as a sequence. You have a sequence, you have a recursive relation for the sequence, and now you basically want to compute the nth element in that sequence. Also, sums and products can be defined recursively. And we already saw this before. We saw that you have to start with one element, the sum from I equal 1 to 1 of A of I is A of 1. And then the sum of from I equal 1 to n of A of I is equal with the sum from I equal 1 to n minus 1 of A of I plus A of n, the last element. And similarly for product, we already saw, we actually defined product this way when we defined it earlier today in the lecture. Also, we defined this. Basically, we saw that if you have sums that range between the same ranges, you can rewrite them as a single sum, and vice versa. If you have a sum of a sum, you can break it into two sum notations. And you can prove this by induction. So if you want to prove this by induction, you start with the base case. So the base case is that for the sum from I equal 1 to 1 of A of I plus B of I is actually A of 1 plus B of 1, but A of 1 is the sum from I equal 1 to 1 of A of I plus the sum from I equal 1 to 1 of B of I. So this P of n is true. The inductive formula basically is you want to prove, you are given in the inductive hypothesis that the sum from I equal 1 to k of A of I plus B of I is the sum from I equal 1 to k of A of I plus the sum from I equal 1 to k of B of I. And you want to use it in proving that P of k plus 1 is also true, that this equality also holds. We start from the left-hand side of this equality, and using recursion, we take out the last term. So the sum from the range from 1 to k plus 1 is the sum from the range from 1 to k plus the last element, which was A of k plus 1 plus B of k plus 1. But now you can write the inner formula using the inductive hypothesis as two sums. And then in each one of those two sums, by commutativity of summation, you can group the first term with the third term and basically using again recursion to put back into the sum from 1 to k plus 1. And similarly for the second sum of b's. And now you basically showed that the sum from 1 to k plus 1 can be rewritten as two sums of the a's and the b's. So again, we used induction to prove sums of sums. Recursion. There are two sequences that are useful in mathematics. Arithmetical sequences and geometric sequences. So arithmetical sequences are of the following form. You are given the base case, some k equals 0, and then you basically have to you are given the recursive formula. A of k is equal with A of k minus 1 plus d. It follows that the recursive formula for A of n is A of 0 plus d multiplied with n for all integers n greater than or equal with 0. And this is easily shown using induction. You basically assume it to be true for some k. Then you see that for k plus 1, you add another d. So this becomes d multiplied with k plus 1. So it's exactly the same formula for the next element after k. Geometric sequences are those recurrence relations where A of k is equal with R multiplied with A of k minus 1. So you multiply with R the next term. Again, it follows that A of n can be written as explicitly with R to the power n multiplied with A of 0, the original element. So we get from a recursion to an explicit formula for the elements of the sequence. There are also what are called second-order linear homogeneous recurrence relations with constant coefficients. Is a recursive relation of the form A of K is defined recursively as A, a constant, multiply with A of K minus 1, plus B, multiply of K of A of K minus 2. For all integers K greater than some fixed number, but that fixed number has to be two steps after the base cases. Because for any element, you need two elements in the back to basically compute the current element. I will not go into the supplemental material. So the rest of these slides are actually the fact that you can prove correctness of algorithms using induction. And it's done through something called variance. They are defined for while loops and for any statements in programming languages. But again, this part is supplemental. It's not used, it's not tested in the exam. So I will leave it for you to read from the lecture notes if you want. That's all for today. We finished just on time for the recitation. Thank you very much for today. I will post the two recordings right after the lecture today. And following the lecture, the TAs will actually do the recitation. Thank you very much. Excellent. So let's stop the recording.